Isn't just a beautiful day? I think it's been a great week. Last month, in the month of May, we normally have about 20 days of temperatures exceeding 90 degrees. We had zero. This month, we've had zero 95 or above days. So if anybody's complaining about the weather, you're just wrong. It is beautiful out there. I'm sure that God will make up for it pretty quickly, though. It will start getting warm. Well, I'm glad that y'all could join with us tonight. How about joining in some singing as well? Grab your hymnal and stand up and turn to page 127. That's hymn 127, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." Hymn 127.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me 'neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
And on that last verse, I'm so glad I learned to trust Thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that Thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Amen. Isn't it sweet to know that we have a Savior who loves us? I tell you what, I think it is sweet to trust in Jesus. Turn with me to number 102, "He Hideth My Soul." That's hymn 102. Good old Fanny Crosby for you.
My soul.
the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of a rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
Amen. Let's bow for prayer. Father, we thank you tonight for your blessings. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful song we just sang, He Hideth My Soul in the Cleft of the Rock that covers a dry and thirsty land. Lord, we're so thankful that we can come in this evening, Lord, and we can lift up our hearts to you, that we can cry out to you. Lord, there's various needs that are in this building tonight. Lord, there's family that's lost loved ones. There's family that are in the hospital. There's family, Lord, needing transplants. There's family, Lord, that are going through difficulties, maybe within their family of maybe it's in a marriage, maybe it's with children, whatever. And Lord, what we need is a God that's with us and hides us, Lord, in the cleft of the rock, and Lord, that covers us with his hand. Heavenly Father, I just pray tonight, Lord, that as we come to you, Lord, that as we lift up our voices and sing, as we, Lord, lift up our voices in prayer, as we study the Word of God together, Lord, give us something tonight that's going to help us, encourage us, and strengthen us, Lord, to finish out this week very strong. Lord, that we come back and on Sunday morning and be excited about what you've done so far. Father, we give you the thanks, the praise, the honor, and the glory in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Appreciate you being here tonight. It's a great blessing to have all of you. I do appreciate those of you who have prayed for Miss Carrie and her family. Her mother passed away, and the service was today. They honored me and with the privilege of doing that service. I had not known Miss Hill that long, just from the time she'd been in the hospital, but we had developed a relationship in the Lord and got an opportunity to visit with her and just ask her, did she know for sure that she had a home in heaven? And she assured me that she knew Jesus as her personal Lord and Savior, and that she was ready to go home. She was not worried about that at all. She didn't want to leave her family, of course, but she was excited about the prospects of meeting her Savior, and so had a great ease in doing that service this afternoon. And so if you would continue to pray for the family, got to meet a number of the family, and was a blessing. The service was well attended. We got to preach the gospel, and at least 10 raised their hand that they had trusted Christ as Savior. And Miss Carrie and her sister were very excited about that, as well as some of the other family members that were there. Very kind and gracious they were, and but continue to pray for them, if you will. Also, this evening I got a text from Dara Jackson, and I think there's a post if you're on Facebook with her. Her dad had a heart attack. I'm not sure what the prognosis is. They said his blood pressure was fine and all of that, but they've got him in under sedation. They're putting him on ice to kind of keep him pretty well sedated and all, so they can find out what's going on. He's in Herman Hospital, and so if you would pray for Brother Darrell Jackson, we would appreciate that. And then also Mrs. Sherry Williams, I've had these two on the prayer list, and she needs to have a defibrillator put in, and she's been down in Ascension Hospital. She's supposed to have it done on Monday. I went down and had prayer with her, and they were supposed to do it at 1 o'clock, and Obamacare has got that all messed up, and she's going to have to go downtown to St. Joseph's Hospital in order to have it done, and they're waiting for word from the doctors in order for them to get there, so they'd send her home with a defibrillator that she wears. So do be in prayer for her, if you will. Also, the other names that we have on the list, that Patty continue to pray for her, and the dialysis, as well as getting her on the transplant list, and also Deputy Clint, he needs to be saved, and he still has not responded to salvation. He's so continue to pray for him, if you will. Also, Miss Davita Rosser, his pastor's wife, Second Baptist Church in Highlands, has cancer. Continue to pray for her. Brother Paul Brantner, if you would, continue to pray for him. Brother Alan Reedland, Brother David Reedland's father, continue to pray for him also. And I had one that just ran through my mind. It didn't stay long enough to catch that. Man, I tell you, these senior moments, they're awful. Don't encourage me here. Anyway, so, but there was something that came across my mind that went right straight through it, and it didn't stay long enough, but it'll come back to me about 2 o'clock in the morning. I'll send y'all all text messages and call you and let you know what it was, I guess. If I can remember your phone numbers, that's the thing there. But anyway, I do appreciate your prayers. I did get a chance. I have been approved. I told you I got a chance to get approved for Harris County Sheriff's Office to do chaplaincy in the Harris County jails, and I spent about 5 hours there on Monday. Had a great time in jail. You say, how can you have a great time in jail? I have a good time wherever I go, and I'll just tell you that. And in fact, at the funeral today, you know, I don't know what I said that was funny, but anyway, one of the kids met me outside here and said, "You're funny." I'm going, "Yeah, I get that a lot." So, but I don't know if it's the looking or the whatever it is, but had a great time. Got a chance to visit with a number of inmates, pray with them as well. And now that I know what to do and how to, when it's a whole lot different than going into the state jails. And so privilege of going in, knowing how to get into each of the cells and how to get into the inmates and all of that. It was a blessing just to be able to learn that on Monday as well. I got to go down in on second floor where they had the deaf inmates, and I got a chance to spend about an hour and a half with them, and just visit with them and get to know them a little bit. And so that is always exciting to me when I can communicate with the deaf. And also, if you would pray for Brother Arthur Craig, he's the pastor of Woodhaven Baptist Church, Deaf Baptist Church in Houston. His wife passed away about a month and a half ago, and he goes once a month there and does a chapel service for the deaf, and he's not been able to be there for about a month and a half, and so they were asking me about him. I do know him. I just don't know all of the ins and outs of all that, but do pray for he and his family at this time also as they recover from that. If there's, this can't catch it as it flies by. Anyway, I need to drink coffee or something to speed my brain up. Anyway, if you have somebody you'd like to add to the prayer list this evening, if you would, we'll start on this side and work this way. That does my right to left thing a whole lot better than it going from this way. So anyway, if somebody in this section over here, Brother Kurt. Yeah, okay. All right, Ms. Shazu, and the new treatment for the migraines. All right. Anybody else in this section over here? Ms. Amanda? Okay, Amanda's nephew flies to from California, Missouri. All right, anybody else in that section? All right, this section over here? Yes, Ms. Bridget. That wasn't the one that flew through, but Miss Bridget that sits back here in this section on the very back broke her foot, and she thinks it's bruised. The doctor says it's broke, so I don't know what her medical degree is, but anyway, she wants to get out, and so I talked to her yesterday, visited with her, had prayer with her, and she said the doctor said 6 to 8 weeks in skilled care, so and doing that. So just be in prayer for her, if you will, Miss Bridget. Okay, Brother Jimmy. Those big ships, they look really amazing, but they're not really all that much fun. I'm just telling you. I almost joined the Navy because of the big, is it number 77? I saw there at Norfolk when I was there. I had better thought once I got away from the ship. But be prayer for Pete as he joins the Navy, and also for Michael as he preaches tonight. Okay, Melissa. Continue to pray for Fred. As she was saying, he's going to have a surgery that's scheduled on the 9th of July. And also there's a young man that's going to come stay with them that is having some issues. And so he's coming in July. So if you would be in prayer for a young man by the name of Jared, all right? And then, of course, unspoken request. Miss Vicky's friend Joan, if you continue to pray for her. All right. This section over here, Miss Frankie. Amen. Amen. That is a praise. Amen. Amen. That's great. Amen. That's great. It's always good when God works, isn't it? I'll tell you, that's for sure. Amen. All right. Anybody else in this section? Pray for Miss Sexton. I know that one. That was one that went through my mind. And then when I saw Miss Veldish raise her hand, I thought, oops, I forgot about Miss Sexton. She had eye surgery yesterday, and she'll have to be out for a few days. So just pray for her. The surgery went well, and everything's fine. Just continue to pray for her. And also for Larry, if you would. It is Larry, right? Miss Cassie? Jim. Okay. All righty. Pray for him, if you will, also. Okay, anybody in this section over here? Miss Sandra? All right. We'll pray for Caden as he flies to Saudi Arabia. He'll be with his dad for a few weeks, so just be prayer. Heather? Okay, Heather for a job. All right, Deborah. Okay, Mr. Rouse, if you will. All right. Right. Sarah has a cyst in her inner ear, and that has to be removed. They're going to do that on July the 7th, 16th. And also, they will be traveling. Will not be here this weekend. We're not supposed to announce that because then our you people don't show up. So anyway, so if you're watching by live stream, that you didn't really hear that, okay? All right. Anybody else? Okay. Don't forget our Wednesday night services, our Keep Steady Growth, KSG. Don't forget our Highland Soul Winning on Saturdays. And I don't know what the weather's going to do this weekend, but we'll do something. Also, our missions conference is October the 15th through the 19th with Jimmy Banks is coming. Looking forward to that. As well as our vacation Bible school is going to be July the 7th through the 11th from 6 to 8 p.m. If you've not yet started passing out flyers in your neighborhood, please do so. And just be a part of that if you will help us with the VBS. Every soul that's saved, every life that's changed, it's well worth all the funds that we give in response to those that are saved during that time. And so be in prayer for that, if you will. Our missionaries are Brother Mark and Christy Helzerman, Papua New Guinea, and they are actually in the States on furlough, and they will be with us sometime during October. And so be prayer for them as they travel around reporting back to the churches, hopefully raising some support along the way, as they're on the field, they lose support. Churches lose pastors. In fact, I was talking to Brother Brazil on Sunday night after church, and a church that he was out of in California at that time. The pastor resigned and went into evangelism, and the new pastor came and just cleared off the entire missions projects. I mean, missionaries, you just wiped them all out, sent them all letters and said, we'll no longer support you after this point. And then if you would like to recandidate for our church, you're welcome to do so. I don't understand that. I don't think that's right. Anyway, that's the way they do it. And sometimes, so because of that, some missionaries lose their support while they're on the field. Some churches close. Some churches get into financial difficulties and just can't continue to support the missions. So just be in prayer for your missionaries and the missions programs, if you will. Let's go to the Lord in prayer again. Father, we bow before you again. We just ask, Father, your blessings upon each and every name that was called. Lord, there's a number of needs there. And Lord, I know there are unspoken requests that need to be made, and a special thing upon the heart. Lord, you know exactly what those needs are. Lord, you know what the desire of the heart is. We just pray, Father, that you would work in those hearts, work in those lives. Dearly Father, we pray for the Hill Rouse family, Lord, and the loss of Miss Gertrude. And Lord, I just pray that those that raise their hands, Lord, would make it public in their churches that they got saved, Lord, that find a good church home. Many of them don't live in the area. The ones that do, Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be at the place where, Lord, where we can reach them and get them into the house of God, which would thrill not only Miss Carrie, but also the Miss Gertrude, Lord, as she looks down from heaven from that cloud of witnesses. Then, Heavenly Father, we pray again for for Officer Clint. Lord, all he's been through with the shooting on the job and his health and all of that. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you continue to work in his heart that would bring him, Lord, to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Then, Father, we pray for Miss Patty, Lord, that you get her on that transplant list, and Lord, that you'd help her, Lord, as she goes through that dialysis until that point in time. Lord, that you'd be with her and help her, Lord, encourage her, strengthen her, be with her, Lord, at this time. Also, we pray, Father, for those who are set to go under surgery or those that are having difficulties. We just pray, Lord, that you'd be with them. Pray for Brother Darrell tonight, Lord, as he's at Herman trying to determine what the cause of the problems he has is. And Lord, we just pray that you would give the doctors, Lord, the wisdom, the knowledge, the understanding that they need to have, that, Lord, that you would put it in their heart and their mind exactly what they need to be looking for in order to help and strengthen them. We pray for Miss Sherry, Lord, that you get her, Lord, the surgery that she needs. I realize, Lord, our country's in a mess, and Lord, we've adopted a program, Lord, that is going to be a hardship on most Americans. It's already happening with prescription drugs skyrocketing, with surgeries being postponed and not done in a timely manner. And Lord, any time you give the government control of stuff like that, it seems to be a disaster. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would be with those who need the medical attention, medical care that they need. Lord, that your will would be done and accomplished, and help them, Lord, to open those doors and open those lives. Then, Heavenly Father, we pray, Lord, for the ministries of the church. We pray especially for our Highland soul winning. Lord, I just pray as we get into the area we're in now, Lord, that you would just work in each and every heart and each and every life of each person that we talk to. And Lord, that you'd help us to be mindful, Lord, of their soul salvation and the need of Christ in their life. Lord, many are out there hurting, looking for the answers, and they're looking in the wrong places. They're looking in drugs. They're looking in alcohol. They're looking in promiscuity and all other areas. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would open their hearts as we go out, Lord, and share the gospel with them. And then, Heavenly Father, we ask, Lord, you bless our missions conference, America in Crisis. Lord, it is so evident in our society today that we have taken a far left turn, and we've gone so far away from the precepts and the commands of the Word of God. And Lord, even the churches today are not taking a stand for the right and embracing, Lord, the philosophies of this society we live in. And Lord, we know that that's prophesied in the Word of God, as Jesus wrote to the church of Laodicea, of the Laodiceans. It wasn't to the church, it was to the people, Lord, who have turned their backs and locked the Lord out of the churches. Lord, I pray that you'd send revival across America, and that revival would work in our own hearts, our own lives, Lord, and that we would have a desire, Lord, to see you working in our own community, in our lives. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask your blessings upon the service tonight. Lord, you'd fill me with thy Holy Spirit, with power. Help my mind to stay clear and in tune. And Lord, that we would learn something from the Word of God that's going to be a benefit and a help. And we ask all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
All right. Turn in your hymnal and stand with me to number 220. That's hymn number 220. Jesus is all the world to me. Stand with me, and if the men will come forward on the last verse for the offering, please.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, so when I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trial so. Shall live. Beauty. such a friend. Beautiful life that has no end. Eternal life, eternal joy. He's my friend.
Amen. Jesus is your friend tonight. I want to hear a good hearty amen.
Hey!
Amen. I'll tell you, you know, when you stop and you think about what's going on in this world,
right?
I mean, it's hard. I turned on the TV, this morning, and thinking I was going to watch the weather, and you know, three siblings were killed, and another one shot him and killed himself, and mother comes home and finds those children. That has to be devastating. You know, just the things that are going on in our society. We need a friend. But you know, our friend, our society needs a friend too.
Yes, sir.
There's no greater friend than Jesus.
Amen.
There's no better person to share with them than Jesus.
Right.
And that's what we ought to be doing. Don't forget, as we continue to try to get this note paid off, that's what our Wednesday night offering is going for. We've got a couple of weeks left, and that's it before we have to renew. And just pray that God would miraculously send the funds that we need to get this taken care of. As we bow for prayer, Brother Kurt, you lead us in prayer, please.
My dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful building and beautiful property that you've given us, Lord God. It is amazing. It's something that when I joined this church so many years ago over at the other property, there's no way I would have thought that you would have done something like this with that little church, but you have moved miraculously, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And now it's come to time when we need you to move miraculously again.
Yes, Lord.
We need you to pay it off, so that we can go ahead and move forward and do more things for you, Lord. We don't want to stop here. We want to keep going. But,
yes,
Lord, in order to keep going, we need you to do something. We need you to pay off this debt.
Yeah.
And I believe you can do it. If it's in your will, Lord, I believe that you can just reach down and just give us the money and have it taken care of.
Yes.
Lord, I'd rather that happen than us to keep paying on it and not be able to move forward in other things. And I ask you, please do that. Please go ahead and take care of the bill. And just somebody's out there that we need to go talk to. We need to go tell about Jesus. Somebody we need to invite to church who has that money in their pocket that you want them to give here, but they need to hear about you first. So I ask, Lord God, that you please burden our hearts with the necessity of sharing the gospel, of telling people about your friendship with us, that eternal friendship that never ends, that friendship that will not let us go to hell, but rather, my Lord God, picks us up and establishes us in your kingdom, Lord. I pray you please give us that burden. And tonight, I ask you please fill Brother Jim full of the Holy Spirit. Lord, I need to hear something, and I'm sure everybody does, or else we wouldn't be here. So please just encourage us and bless us, and just give us what we need. Please accept this offering, bless it, use it for your work and for your will. Again, I ask the Lord, would you please take care of this debt so we can move forward with other things. In the name of Christ Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Christ is coming, he is coming, and when we do not know the hour, O sinner, you're not ready till you taste his saving power. Lord Jesus, come quickly and take thy children home. Are you ready for his coming when Jesus claims his own? As he went up into heaven, so he cometh from the sky. O Christian, will you serve him for redemption? Draw with nigh. He will come in power and glory, and the dead in Christ shall rise. Then we who still are living shall be caught up in the skies. Lord Jesus, come quickly and take thy children home. Are you ready for his coming when Jesus claims his own?
If you will take your Bibles, turn to the book of Luke, chapter number 9. The book of Luke, chapter number 9. I told you last week we're going to start a series of messages on following the Master. Following the Master. Matthew chapter 4, Jesus told Peter and Andrew, follow me and I will make you to become fishers of men. Following that, he saw James and John, the sons of Zebedee, and he said, follow me. In both instances, it says that he immediately they followed him. And when we are called or when we follow Christ, it should be immediate reaction. It shouldn't be, well, let me think about it for a little while. No, it should be immediate. And sometimes we don't respond, probably. One is we're not quite sure exactly what God wants us to do. I've had people through the years say, preacher, well, I know God wants me to do something. I just don't know what to do. What do I do? And I said, well, just do what you're supposed to do until God shows you what you need to do, and he'll make it clear. God doesn't call those that aren't doing anything. I've heard people say, well, I'm just sitting here waiting for God to call me. You know, God doesn't call people that aren't going to do something. If you're not going to do something now, you're not going to do something later. God doesn't call the guy to go to the mission field not winning souls here in home. Because if they're not winning souls here at home, they're not going to win souls when they get to the mission field. All they're going to do is send a monthly letter and take some pictures and make you feel sad and dejected and make you feel like that you've got to support them when they're not even doing the job, just sitting at home collecting a paycheck. There's a few preachers in our society that are doing the same thing. God called me, but yeah, he called you to be busy. As a pastor, it's my responsibility to lead this church and to do what God's called me to do, to study the Word of God, to be prepared. As a Christian, he's also called me and empowered me to go out and knock doors. And he's also empowered me to go to the jails and to the nursing homes and to be a witness for him in my neighborhood, in the area. So when he calls us, and he calls all of us, by the way, he didn't, you may not be called to pastor a church, and ladies, that's probably never going to happen. I know a few of them have misread what it is that God has asked him to do. God doesn't call women to the pastorate. You can't have authority over men. And in order to be a pastor, you've got to have authority over men. So God didn't call you to do that. I know that's not popular today, but it's as biblical today as it was back when it was written. But God has a ministry for you, You can do Bible studies with ladies. You can work in the jails. I mean, there's, I hope this doesn't go out. I was just thinking, I don't know if I should say this or not, but when I'm going into the jail, I was in there, and there's a couple of ladies in there, and they're working with the women down in the cell blocks. And one of them handed me some magazine and said, some of your people used to visit, they may want to read this magazine. And I looked at the top of the magazine. I said, yeah, they ain't reading that. I'm just telling you, they're not going to read that. And I graciously put them in my little cart, and I graciously hid them, and I graciously put them back on the shelf when I got done. You said, well, what if they're going to do? I said, they can do what they want to do, but I am not putting out something that's got false doctrine, false teaching in it. Just saying that. So, but you can work in the jails. You say, well, that's not my calling. Well, that may not be your calling. Not everybody gets to do that. Not everybody likes that. I don't know why, but God has just gifted me, I say that humbly, to be able to deal in the jails, the nursing homes, the hospitals. I just enjoy doing and being a part of that. You know, that's something I enjoy, but I know not everybody. I've asked some folks, would you like to go to jail with us? Absolutely not. I'm not going there. Well, I understand, you know, that's not for everybody. But God has a work for all of us to do. And what he's given us to do is that we need to be followers of the Master. We need to be followers of Jesus. In Luke chapter number 9, I invite you to read with me and follow along as I read, and stand with me if you would, if you're able. If you're not able, do not feel bad and just sit and follow along. But Luke chapter number 9, I want to read verses 57 through 62 this evening and just preach to you on the subject, am I a real disciple? Am I a real disciple? Notice what you read in Luke chapter number 9, verse 57. And it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said to him, and speaking of Jesus, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And Jesus said unto him, foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And he said unto another, and this is Jesus speaking now, follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. Jesus said unto him, let the dead bury their dead. But go thou and preach the kingdom of God. Another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go and bid them farewell which are at my house. Jesus said unto him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. There's three gentlemen that are represented here, and I would say that there's three groups of people, really, that are represented here. Am I a real disciple? Let's pray. Father, as we bow before you again, I ask, Father, that you speak to our hearts. Lord, that you would examine our hearts and help us, Lord, to realize who Jesus is. Lord, I just pray this evening, Lord, that you speak to our hearts and that you'd encourage us. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. In the funeral this afternoon, I used John chapter 16, and where Jesus says, you'll see me, you'll not see me, and then you'll see me. And they began to question with themselves of why. You know, what does he mean by this? You're not going to see me, and then you're going to see me. And he said, you're questioning with yourselves. And he explained to them, he's going to leave, and then he's going to come back, and he's going to collect us together, corporately together, collectively together, and take us to heaven. Those of us who are saved, and those who are unsaved, of course, will be left here. And he said, you sorrow not as others which have no hope. And you and I, as a child of God, have hope. But my question to the audience this afternoon and to you tonight is, who is Jesus to you? Let me state that again. You might want to write it on the back of your bulletin, and maybe you want to take some notes down in your own thinking, and answer the question in your own heart and in your own way. But the question is, who is Jesus to you? I'm not asking collectively as a group. I'm asking you individually, separately, within your own heart and in your own mind, who is Jesus to you? Now, some will say, well, he's a good man. That's what a lot of religious people say. Well, he was a good man. You know, Jesus asked the disciples, he said, who do men say that I am? Some say, well, some say you're a prophet. Some say you're Jeremiah. Some say you're... He said, but who do you say that I am? In your own heart and in your own mind, who is Jesus to you? You see, the answer to that question is going to be a determination of how you're going to serve him. If he's just a good man, if he just is a man filled with wisdom, if he's just a man that is a quote-unquote prophet, you're not going to serve him the same way as if you would answer the question by saying, he is my Savior, my Lord, my Redeemer. You see, the difference is in your perception. Who is Jesus to you? As we look at Luke chapter number 9, and as we study around, and you see, Jesus has done a number of things. He's healed sick. He's caused blind eyes to see, deaf ears to hear, lame legs to walk. He's raised the dead. The woman with the issue of blood has been healed by touching the hem of his garment. He's preached the Sermon on the Mount. He's done a number of things, and he's impacted the region with the gospel of Jesus Christ, with his gospel. And even with the impact that he's made upon society, many people say, well, yeah, he's a good man. He's a great healer. If I call some names of some popular folks and I say, who is that individual to you? What would you say about that individual? If I called the name of Billy Graham, there's probably not a one of you in this auditorium that does not know who Billy Graham is. And maybe Billy Graham had an impact upon your life, and maybe even under the ministry of Billy Graham, maybe you came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and that's a wonderful thing. And you say, well, to me, Billy Graham is a great preacher. To me, Billy Graham is a great orator, or he is one that's brought thousands to the Lord. But there's going to be that one individual that's going to say he was responsible through his preaching, through his crusades, of bringing me to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. We might say to you, who is Jimmy Swaggart? To you, who is Jimmy Swaggart? Well, to some, they would say he's a great singer. He was the cousin of Jerry Lee Lewis. Brother Steve sang a song that Jimmy Swaggart sang a number of years ago, There Is a River. I mean, honestly and truthfully, in years gone by, he was a good preacher. I didn't agree totally with his doctrine, but he was a good preacher. But to somebody, Jimmy Swaggart was the one that brought me to Christ. You see, somebody had made an impact, and Jesus had made an impact on those whom he ministered to in his day and time. But it's interesting to note that when you read the end of Matthew, when you read the end of Mark, and when you read the end of Luke, and you read the end of John, those same disciples that followed him for 3.5 years forsook him. One of them cursed and said, I know not the man. You see, we can stand up and wave our hands and say, well, Jesus is my Savior, he's my Lord. But who is really Jesus to you? As we look at these three men that came to Jesus, two of them volunteered for service. One of them was called. Now, the first one that volunteered, notice, if you will, in verse number 57, he says, and it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, that's Jesus, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. I'll be honest with you. sometimes the excitement of what's going on at the house of God, or what's going on in the ministry, is what motivates people to do something. I don't mean to be unkind, but that's exactly what's happening in downtown Houston. There's a lot of people that are following an image. That's all they're doing. It looks good. It looks glamorous. It looks great. But you see, you need to understand something. When you volunteer in the ministry of God, when you surrender and volunteer to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, you need to understand something. There is not a whole lot of stability in what goes on. You say, well, preacher, there has to be stability. Oh, yeah, there's some stability. But I'll tell you, the Christian life is a series of ups and downs. When you're up on the mountain and life's at its peak, man, everything's great. But when you're down in the valley, you see, there's not a whole lot of stability there, because I tell you, the people that love you today will hate you tomorrow. The people that are hugging you and loving you today are the same people that will stab you in the back tomorrow. You say, well, preacher, you're preaching a very negative message. No, I'm not trying to be negative here. What I'm trying to say is it happened to Jesus, and it's going to happen to you. We just recounted what Jesus did. He healed the sick. He caused blind eyes to see, deaf ears to hear, lame legs to walk, raised the dead. Look what he did. And there's a lot of people that praised him, but when it came time for him to go to the cross of Calvary, they all forsook him. Not just his disciples, everyone forsook him. All of those, it doesn't say that blind Bartimaeus, who was healed from his blindness, sat at the grave and looking up and wept at the death of Jesus. It doesn't say that the 10 lepers that were healed, where only one of them came back and sat down at the foot of the cross and looked up with weeping and tears and said, I can't believe that we did this to you. You see, the Christian life is not an area of stability, because we're going to have our ups and our downs. People are going to praise you, and people are going to criticize you. And probably the same people that did. Jesus, look what Jesus' response was. He said, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. You see, there's not a whole lot of provision in this either. Because what we're looking at is we're looking at the glamour. We're looking at the glitz, and we're saying, oh, the ministry is a wonderful thing. I'll be honest with you. Can I be transparent? When I was 16 years old and I was in a church that was running 1,200, we were running 27 buses. We were seeing souls saved every week. We were seeing people baptized every week. We had a Christian school. We had everything going. We had great preachers in, like Jack Hiles and Lester Roloff and Carl Hatch. We just had great things were going. Great guns were. This is exciting to see a attitude of revival that's breaking out within the church. And man, we're so excited, and we're praising God, and we're loving God, and everything's going great. And for me, a 16-year-old, I'm saying, man, this is great. I love the ministry. Man, I love working the bus route. I love going every Friday night to Pascagoula or to Gulfport and going to the hospital and seeing people saved in the hospital every week. I love what God is doing. And God spoke to my heart, and God called me to preach, and I was excited about preaching the Word of God. But you see, I looked at the glitz and the glamour of it. But there's not always glitz and there's not always glamour. What these people are looking at, they're seeing what Jesus has accomplished and what Jesus has done. But when it all comes down to the bottom line, are you willing to kneel down at an old-fashioned altar and cry out to God and say, all men have forsaken me? All have left me? There's no place to lay my head. There's no place to go. I have spent my life in the ministry, in the service of God, and look where I'm at right now. Yeah, look where you're going to be. You see, that's what happens is many times we get excited about the ministry, and when things don't go our way, when things don't happen the way we want, we teach a Sunday school class, and well, nobody's getting saved. The Sunday school class isn't growing. You know why people aren't getting saved? You know why the Sunday school class isn't growing? It's because you're not going. You're not doing the work. You're not out there putting the shoe leather out there. You see, it's important when we're going to serve God, but I guarantee you when you come around on the bottom side of that too, we get lonely. The ministry is a lonely area. Do you realize if you have family members that aren't serving God, that you become the butt of the joke? That they look down their nose at you, and they literally schedule the family reunion so that you have to miss church on Sunday? Or they bring alcohol and call you on the phone and say, hey, we're having a family reunion on Saturday, but there's going to be drinking, which is French for you probably don't want to come. And if you come, we're going to look down our nose at you because you shouldn't be here anyway. Because we expect you not to show up because we're drinking. That's what your family's saying between the lines, folks. We know you take a stand against this, and if you show up and you support this, then there's a problem. We know your testimony's not where it ought to be. So the first one says, Lord, I'll volunteer. Man, I'm great guns. Yeah, Jesus says, yeah, it's not all glitz and glamour. It doesn't say what the reaction he had. It just says, look, if you're going into the ministry for the glitz and the glamour and the praise and the accolades of all of that, stay home. Amen. Don't be involved. Because it's not that. I appreciate Brother Joey. He's not here tonight. He's working. I got a text from him. I think it's because he didn't want me to see his haircut. He sent me a picture, Miss Shara, so he did. So anyway, and you're right. He looks like he came out of the mental ward. Just saying. Just saying. I appreciate Brother Joey and Miss Shara. Every Friday night. Now, I realize they miss some. Brother Joey has to work, and Brother Mark or myself or Brother JP or Brother Hutton, you know, somebody has to fill in for him. But do you realize that for almost 8 years now, week after week, month after month, he's dealt with that ministry? And he's had some great successes. And he's been kicked in the teeth a whole lot more than the success. But it keeps on keeping going. You see, that's what it's about. You know, when you surrender to ministry, it's not about all the praise you're going to get. and that's what happens a lot of times. I want to teach Sunday school class, but you know, the preacher, I'm not teaching that class no more because I don't get any praise from the preacher. I don't get any praise from the staff. Nobody says anything kind to me. Nobody's mentioned the fact that we had somebody saved out of our class this last week. I'm not going to do that. If I'm going to get the praise, you know, the ministry is not about praise and accolades. It's about doing what's the right thing to do. If you've got to have a certificate at the end of the year that you've been a faithful teacher for the year, or you've got to have your name up on the marquee up here, or if you have to have some kind of praise or some kind of gift card or some kind of letter of recommendation or something, you're in it for the wrong reason. I'm just saying. Notice the third one. I want to go there because then I'm going to come back to the next one. I want you to come down now to verse number 61. He says, and another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go and bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. There's a three-letter word, a conjunction, in that verse. I would like you to circle if you write in your Bibles. If you don't write in your Bibles, make a mental note. That word is but. I will follow thee, but. You cannot do anything in ministry if you're going to put an exception there. Because a lot of people say, well, Lord, I'll follow you, but I want the bigger church. I'll be perfectly frank and honest. I'm trying to be transparent tonight. I'm trying to help you to understand something about the ministry. But let me tell you something. There are some preachers out there that they're only at the church they're at to step to the next church, the next larger church, and then to step to the next larger church. It is a stepping stone. That's all it is. Folks, if you're going to be involved with the ministry and you want a bigger class, build it. If you want a bigger church, build it.
Yes, sir.
Don't use it as a stepping stone to the next level. This is not the business world. I have people tell me all the time, well, you need to run the church like a business. No, you can't run the church like a business because a business is geared to making money. And I will guarantee you the ministry is not a money-making proposition unless you're certain men who are preaching a false doctrine and a false teaching and gathering great hordes of money to build houses with gold faucets and air-conditioned dog houses and theme parks and drive fancy cars and all of it. I mean, that's their own focus, and that's all that they're interested in. They're only interested in it for the money, and that gives a bad name for all of us. But it also gives a bad name if you're using your ministry to step to the higher ministry. If you're not willing to fight, if you're not willing to build and work where you're at, then you don't deserve it. And I hope every preacher that watches on live stream understands that. If you're not willing to work it and you're not willing, you see, the dictionary, success is the only place that it comes before work. The only way you're going to have success is work. You're going to have to do it. You can't sit back and expect everybody else to do it. Everybody else isn't going to build your Sunday school class. Everybody else isn't going to build your choir. Everybody else isn't going to, well, you know, if they go out more on Saturday and do more on Saturday, then we would have more people on Sunday. Well, we can't about 10 of us go out every Saturday and expect to have 10,000. Folks, it's work. When God called me to the Garthrow Baptist Church, there was a series of events that took place. Because, I'll be honest with you, I was looking to go. I wasn't looking to stay. I'm just being transparent. I'm just telling you how I was. In 2005, I was looking to go. In fact, I was getting emails, I was getting letters, I was getting phone calls to Canada, and God never would allow me to go. And finally, I'm sitting at the bank one day, and I'm saying, God, you know that my heart's desire is to pastor. I've been an associate for 20 years. Lord, I'm ready to step into the pulpit. I'm ready to lead a church. I'm ready to do. And God, I think I've proven myself. I haven't stepped on and gone to every church along the way. I haven't given myself, and I haven't suggested that some of the church call me. I haven't done any of that, Lord. I've tried to be faithful right here at the Garthrow Baptist Church, and Lord, and I'm sitting here in the bank, and I'm praying as they're working on the deposit, and God speaks to me through a song on the radio. I've never heard it since. I've never heard it before, and I can't even tell you all the words, but I know that what God said was, Jim, I know exactly where you're at.
Yes, sir.
I know exactly what you're doing, and I'm going to use you right there.
Amen.
And this great peace came over my life. I didn't know in less than probably a month that Brother Ed was going to go in the hospital and never be back in the pulpit again. I didn't know that. I'm just seeking God's will. I want God to bless me. I want God to use my family, and we want to serve God. I mean, and honestly and truthfully, at that point in time, I was willing to go anywhere that God would use me, but God said, no, I want you right there. And I said, I'll stay. And the only two that knew that commitment was my wife and I. I didn't share it with anybody. Nobody. The church said, we need a pastor. I showed them exactly what needed to be done. And I stepped back and I said, guys, you're responsible. We want you to be the pastor. I said, it doesn't work that way. It don't work that way. You've got to find the heart of the people. You've got to know what the people want to do. This is what you have to do. If you want me, then you're going to have to put me in there and say, we're going to have a vote, and we're going to say, Brother Lamb, but I'm not bringing up the vote. And I'm not doing it. You're doing this, not me. And they brought it for a vote, and the vote was 98%. And on the day that the vote came in for 98%, I said, God, if this is your will and I'm going to be here, I don't want to go anywhere else. I'm not looking. I'm not entertaining calls from anybody. I'm exactly where I feel like God wants me to be. And I told God I want to die at Garthrow Baptist Church. Now, folks, I'm not trying to promote myself. What I'm trying to say is you're going to have to make a decision in your life. You're going to have to make a determination. You cannot put any buts in your call, in your surrender. God, I will do all of this, but... No. In fact, notice the terminology that Jesus uses in verse number 62. And Jesus said unto him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. That is a word, my mind just went again. That is just a way of saying, looking back with regrets. Folks, you can't look back with regret. There's some of you that are sitting here in this auditorium tonight, and you're looking at, and you're thinking of your life. I mean, I hear preachers all the time. Well, if God hadn't called me to preach, I could be a millionaire in a company, be CEO of a company. That's looking back with regret. I could have done this, but God got in my way. No. God says you can't put a butt there. You can't look back and say, well, I'd be a whole lot better off if I'd follow this other path. No. You can't look back with regret. You gotta keep your eyes on the target. You gotta keep your eyes on the cross. You gotta keep your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ, because there's a lot of things around you that are vying for your time, that are vying for your attitude, that are vying for you to follow off and to go in that direction. Folks, you gotta stay strong. Amen. He said, no man putting his hand to the plow and looketh back is fit for the kingdom of God. You see, there's too many times that, you know, we look back and we go, man, I wish I had a. I wish I hadn't a. I wish I did. No, it's just doing the right thing. And if you're going to volunteer for the ministry, if you're going to volunteer to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you say, Lord, I want to be used in your ministry, whatever the ministry is, don't put a conjunction in there. A youth director years ago, the church I was in, was teaching along. I've heard this used in several different avenues and several different ways of talking about surrender. And he's talking about drawing a circle on the floor and saying, Lord, I will give you everything in that circle and stand in the circle. By the way, don't take your billfold out. Amen. Don't take your checkbook out. I'll give you everything, but, no, can't put the conjunction there. I give you everything. I give you everything. I realize my time is gone, but I want to do the third one really quickly. Look in verse number 59. And he said unto another, Jesus is talking here, follow me. There's a three-letter word there I would like you to put a circle around if you have a tendency to write in your Bibles. Notice what it is. But. He said, Lord, suffer me to go and bury my father. And Jesus said unto him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. Now, there's a play on words here when he says, let the dead bury the dead. There's no indication that his father had died yet. But dead here means to be physically dead, metaphorically, spiritually dead. Let the spiritually dead go bury the physical dead. Why? Because they're not getting anything out of it anyway. And the best thing you can do is just go preach the gospel. Go preach. No reservations. I think it was William Borden. Born into the Borden family. Immediate spoon in his mouth. He went off to Bible college, went off to Yale, and Yale was actually a good college back then. He was a Christian, and he led. When he graduated, there were over 1,400 students at Yale College that were having a Bible study every day. Every day. He surrendered to go to the mission field, and his family cut him off. He said, no reserves. No reserves. No reserves. He was going to India, and he went to China to study and to learn the language. And while he's in China, he contracted a disease and never made it to the mission field. But thousands of people that were around him came to Christ. He said, as he wrote back to his family, no reserves, no regrets. No reserves, no regrets. It's interesting to note, and I as I was studying for this, I came across it, but there's a reference in the reference Bibles that go back to 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse number 20. For sake of time, I'll not go there. You go back and read it for yourself. But Elijah, the prophet of God, was coming past, and he saw Elisha. Elisha was out in the field plowing with his father's oxen, and Elijah cast his mantle on Elisha. Elisha said, let me go bid my father goodbye. In today's vernacular, Elijah said, whatever. Elisha went and said goodbye to his family. Took the yoke of oxen and the plow, made an altar, burnt the plow, sacrificed the oxen, and followed Elijah. Interesting thing about that is, what Elijah was doing was this, or Elisha was doing was this. I am burning everything that would call me back to where I was. I don't want anything to go back to. I've said goodbye to my family. The yoke of oxen are now gone. The plow is gone. And he went and followed Elijah. Elijah did, I believe it was 7 miracles that are attributed to Elijah in the Word of God. And when Elisha followed Elijah, he saw him go up, and Elijah told him, he said, if you see me go up, he said, God will give you a double portion of my blessing. And as Elisha watched him go up, the mantle fell off, and Elisha picked it up and put it on. Went to the Jordan River and beat it across the Jordan River, and the water separated, and he went across. But when you read the life of Elisha, over 14 miracles that Elisha did, he said, let me go say goodbye to my family. But what he did was he said goodbye to his family, and he cut off no reserves, no regrets. If we are going to be a follower of the Master, if we're going to be a follower of Jesus, we're going to have to cut it all off and say no reserves and no regrets. May we stand for prayer. Father, we thank you tonight for your blessings. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, as we study this series of messages on following the Master, Lord, I pray that you'd help us, Lord, as we look tonight. As Jesus was talking, someone comes and says, I want to volunteer. I want to follow you, Jesus, but they're just seeing the glitz and the glamour. Lord, one comes and puts his hand to the plow, but he looks back and has regrets for what it is that he's left behind. I want to be like Lord Elisha. I want to destroy everything that has in my mind, everything that calls me back to the old life and the old ways. And Lord, I want to put a period. I want to say no more. I want to go for you. I want to see you, Lord, work in my life and work in my church and work in my building, Lord, of working and seeing souls saved, lives changed. Lord, I pray that be the prayer of every one of us tonight. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, if God begins to work in your heart. And that would be your prayer tonight. You say, Brother Lamb, I want God. I don't want to be a volunteer with butts. I don't want to be a volunteer that's looking for the glitz and the glamour. I don't want to be a volunteer. I just want to be an Elisha. I just want to be an Elisha. I just want to keep going for God. I want to forget about everything that could have been, would have been, should have been. And I just want to go for God because that's the only thing that matters. As God deals with your heart, the piano begins to play. You move.